There are people around that succeed, but the capacity to really inspire and impart knowledge, I think, comes down to generosity. Being prepared to be vulnerable, and being prepared to share information, and being prepared to really encourage. I started my career with a science degree. Incredibly useful, as it turned out. I discovered film, photography, sound, video, and it was utterly, utterly life-changing. I came to Melbourne in 1987, and I thought, oh, maybe there's a women in film and television here. And there wasn't, it didn't exist. I just thought, okay, well, let's do it. And we did. We just pulled together women in film and television. It was about enthusing others to come on board and say, hey, let's get behind this great idea. And I'm pleased to say it's still going. We had our 30-year anniversary this year. 7 years ago, we still had this crazy situation where Natalie Miller, who is still the only woman exhibitor who owns her own business, is constantly the only woman at the table. We thought, this has got to change. This is ridiculous. A group of us decided to set up an organisation and started offering an annual fellowship to encourage, to recognise, to nurture the next generation of female leaders. Now more and more women are actually starting to shape the content we see on our screens. The Dressmaker is a perfect example. When I started raising finance for that film, the feedback from all the men that I needed to pitch that project to was great script, really good idea, but female skewed, i.e. not commercial. I go to the movies, I look around in the audience, and who's there? I mean, women go to the movies. But it was deemed too great a commercial risk and it was knocked back. It was only Universal Pictures who went, oh, female skewed, yes, and we love it. They welcomed us with open arms, and the rest is history, because it made more than $20 million at the box office, and now there's a slew of films in its wake that are overtly targeting that female audience. When I started out, there weren't all that many women role models in the film industry as producers. In fact, one of the few around then, and somebody who was an inspiration to me, was Pat Lovell, producer of Gallipoli and Picnic at Hanging Rock. Anarchic, fun, a feminist, as somebody who was passionate beyond belief. And I realised, oh, okay, you can be all of those things and a film producer. But I've been really lucky to be surrounded by inspiring women. I sometimes make films about them. More recently, making a film about Jill Bilcock, and to this day, Jill remains an absolute inspiration for me to be on the edge of creative risk-taking. One of the things I learnt the hard way is that when you're a producer and you're running a business, there is no downtime unless you give yourself permission to take that downtime. You do have to start to really think seriously when your partner says to you, as mine did to me at the end of The Dressmaker, after, you know, 4 years of intensity like you wouldn't believe, she said to me, I'm sick of being single in this relationship. And it's kind of like, whoa, okay. We're going to do things differently next time. It's very easy to keep putting yourself at the bottom of the pile. Recognise that, yes, you have to work intensely hard in order to make any work in this highly competitive media industry we all work in. But equally, you carve out the dates in your diary and you tell people and you say, I will be away from this date and this date. And I learnt that the sky doesn't fall in. After all of the chaos and wonder that it was having a hit movie, I needed to do what was right for me. And for me, that is with my partner going bush, somewhere beautiful and quiet and away. What can happen is people spend a lot of time in the business and start taking on jobs or choosing films or work, start to lose the edge of why they got into it in the first place. To me, that's the key. Remain curious and never stop taking creative risks.